no matter what they tell you, no matter what they do, no matter what they teach you, what you believe is true. And I will keep you safe and strong, shelter from the storm.
There are several verses that do, but the fact is, the Bible does not condemn gays. Fix this. So, why do you want to use the Bible to say gay is sin? I have YouTube, and I get a lot of comments on YouTube, and there's some of you just really strongly believe that the word sodomite believes gay is sin. Well, sodomite doesn't believe, isn't another word for gays. The word sodomite is another word for male temple prostitute. And in ancient days, when Jesus was around and when Moses was around, and because in the Old Testament there are five places that use the word sodomite. In the New Testament, there's two places. No. And this word in the Greek, it's arsenikotes, and it's kadosh in the Hebrew. And we got history of the documentation of how often this word was used after Paul used it. And counting Paul, for the next 400 years, this word was used 56 times. And up to the 14th century, in all usage of it, Greek and Hebrew and anybody else, it was used 76 times. And when you read the documentation on this to see how it was used and how it defined arsenikotes, which is the word sodomite, it does not talk about gays or even hints to gays. So when you're using this word or any Bible word, you ought to be able to research the words to make sure that it's not what you think it means. Now, we're living in perilous times, great deceptions. Deception started with Westcott and Hort in how they translated a corrupt manuscript from Latin Vulgate into Greek, and then translated back into English, and that became the official Church of England Bible where all modern translations come from. So if you're using a modern translation, you could pretty much figure that you have 50,000 to 80,000 corruptions. So always remember when you're studying the Bible to figure out where it is coming from. You should easily figure out that we're living in the days of great deceptions. And the great deceptions couldn't really begin until Israel became a nation back in 1948. After that, that generation won't pass away, so we know Jesus' return is relatively soon, meaning that it's within whoever was born on in 1948, possibly 1967, because that's when Jerusalem became back to belonging to Israel. So you could calculate how long people live. There's lots of people say a generation is this or that or the other number of years, and that generation won't pass away. So counterfeit Bibles would work really good to people that might be alive when Jesus returns. And so that when you read a corrupt version, the version is basically designed to take Christ out of Jesus. And this is when you're reading modern versions, you've got 50,000 to 80,000 corruptions, like I said, and they come from Westcott and Hort of the 1880s. And these two people, they actually started the Ghost Club. And Ghost Club basically is occultist in nature, and that if you're going to be one of the New World Order elite, help and run Antichrist Kingdom, it's a requirement to be a member of this club. And this is from these two people, Westcott and Hort, this is how come you hold in your hand a modern version Bible. And in some of those modern versions, they've taken out the word arsenicotes and they inserted a word that's not even in the Bible, and that's homosexual. And so if you read in your Bible the word homosexual, that word was not in the original. The bad thing is that as time goes on, the deceptions get greater, and part of the deceptions is not only getting modern versions, but getting complementary dictionaries to go along with these modern versions, so that when you read a translation or an interpretation or a definition from a Bible dictionary, you're going to read a modern definition of an ancient word, and that just is not the case. Even some really wonderful concordances in dictionaries have given way to adding meaning to words. The Strong's Concordance originally just simply basically said that arsenicotes was a sodomite. But it's been preached for decades that it is various kinds of homosexuals, until finally you've got modern versions that have the word homosexual in the Bible, which means they had to take out the Greek word. And now when you're looking at even the Strong's, you're going to find additional meanings that was not there originally. You know, the words in it just start meaning something different on their own in Jesus' days. They didn't have a number of meanings back then. They had what it originally meant to be, which was a male temple prostitute, which you have a lot of evidence in that day and age to show you that, yes, this word did mean a temple prostitute. Now, all the fertility gods back in those days were just that, fertility. And so part of the fertility gods were sexual rituals. They were sexual orgies that were ritual. So everybody came in and did everything they wanted sexually in worship of other gods. And one of the most sacred kind of sex for these fertility temples was the male temple prostitutes. There were female temple prostitutes, but they weren't as sacred. And so if you're a a man and you go to a temple prostitute, you want to be the most sacred one you can get. And often these sacred temple prostitutes would dress up as women for the very fact to make the man feel more comfortable because the man is straight. We have other books in the Bible and chapters and verses that are used to condemn gays. And when you do the research on it, you find out when they're translated to English, they often do not have the meaning of the word brought over with them. We should know this by what we commonly refer to, the Greek word love. In English, we only have one word for it. And so when you use it, you have to put in a lot of other descriptive words so you know what kind of love you're talking about. But in the Greek, you don't have to add all these other descriptive words because you just choose the word for love that matches the kind of love you're talking about. Well, in Hebrew, there are also words like this that have, in English, there's only one word. And in Leviticus, this one word was man. Well, in the Hebrew, there was a number of meanings, and one of them would be something that would tell you it's practicing heterosexual man. And this is the word that was used there, practicing heterosexual man. And the other man, of course, because it refers to abomination, which can only be done in acts done while worshiping other gods. That's how abomination is used throughout the Bible, the Old and New Testament, is strictly for the acts done while worshiping other gods. And what was in those days of Moses? Temple prostitutes, male temple prostitutes. And it is comparing this relationship where a heterosexual man that has had sex with women and went to a male temple prostitute, and God considers it similar to a woman that is an adulteress. Because when you look at that womankind, one of the primary meanings of it is an adulterous woman. Already this woman that it's using is a sexually immoral woman. So when you're referring to Leviticus, you're not referring a married heterosexual couple to a gay married couple. And so it's very important that you understand what you're reading about when you want to condemn gays and say God said it or God hates it. And then again, when you want to point the finger and say, well, God is going to cause the United States to fail or decrease in its stature or have a lot of troubles because the government has the last call was it made same-sex marriage legal in all 50 states. And so you say, well, this is the last call. God is definitely going to throw his wrath out on the United States. But the thing is, when God pours out his wrath on places to punish or chastise or whatever for wrongdoing of such, that already you're misunderstanding the Bible, because the Bible doesn't say that God is about to punish. He's not a punisher. But when he does do it, he explains to why he does it. In Leviticus 26, verse 18, it says it's the fourth level of this act. If people disobey God and they don't repent, if his people, that means it's more like the church. If the church as a whole entity disobeys God, then he's going to do all kinds of things. And you can read from 28 on to the end of that chapter about what will happen. And it describes something that apparently can only happen in the tribulation period, because nothing before, nothing ever after will be like what is described in this Leviticus chapter 28 and beyond. And he says, if you obey him, then he'll heal your land. But the thing is, we're at this fourth level. I really strongly believe we get the fourth level of opportunity to repent as a church. And we didn't do it. There's some official attempts, but usually after every attempt to obey God, they actually go out and do worse, because they think obedience to God is to enforce the law of God. And That is not what obedience is. Obedience is to believe that God sent his Son to die on the cross to pay the price for your sins so that you may believe in him and have eternal life and be forgiven. Obedience is believing God. And you can't say believing God is obeying the law of God. God writes his laws on tablets of flesh. That means he wrote his law on your heart to obey them. And we as Christians, we're sinners before we were Christians, we're sinners as Christians, and tomorrow we're going to still be sinners, saved by grace. You're not going to stop sinning just because you're a Christian. There's a lot of things that you can purposely change in your life, and there's a lot of things that will just change because now you're a Christian. Often Christians like to say they notice that they've done a 180 degree turn when they accepted Jesus. So you're heading towards hell, as it were, and then you accepted Jesus and you turned around and started heading to heaven. Now all this way to heaven, you still have full will, full choice, and you could choose what to do. And one of the things the church as a whole is going to choose to do, and that they're going to choose to accept Antichrist as ruler of the world. And this will happen relatively soon, as Antichrist gathers up power, gets just about every other resource in the world to accept him. It's just that the Christians are holding out, and that takes a big chunk of the world, and the Christians need a reason to accept him, because they're leery of this kind of a person anyway, although he's looking more like Jesus to them all the time. But God sends his two witnesses. The two witnesses are going to come out, and they're going to have their ministry for 1260 days, and they're going to be teaching with power a message from God that the church does not want to hear. The church doesn't want to hear that it's been disobedient for 2,000 years. The church, in other words, is saying to God, I'd rather do it myself. And they basically take the glory of God unto themselves. Well, God's going to come back and take the glory back to himself. And through the two witnesses, he's going to show the world something that they don't want to accept. And to church, because the two witnesses backs up what they are saying with all manner of things, that the plagues like Moses did, the 10 plagues, and the two witnesses can do this anytime they want, and much more. And people come to hurt them, fire will come out of their mouth and devour those that try to hurt them. And so you will really hate these two, and Antichrist is promising to kill them. And so this is the final straw. The church as a whole gives their consent to Antichrist becoming the dictator of the world. And then he fulfills the promise, because 30 days later he's able to kill them. Antichrist has 1290 days, and that starts from the very last day of the tribulation, heads up to towards the first day. So that means it'll overlap the two witness ministry by 30 days. 30 days is enough time to kill him. After he kills him, then he stands up in the temple, because now he is basically crowned king of the world, or dictator of the world. And he declares himself God, and he implements the mark of the beast. And it'll, so then the Christians that have given him power, they'll begin to realize the two witnesses' message was correct, and this guy is actually Antichrist, and so you won't take the mark. But you will find it very difficult to survive, because you can't buy or sell. And around 75 days later, just all the Christians would perish, because they can't buy or sell. So God cuts those days short. That's what they cut the day short. Otherwise, you know the hour. When you start seeing the two witnesses, you know that it's getting awfully close. And when the church finally gives its power to this man to be dictator of the world, then basically you could calculate another 1290 days and Jesus would be coming in the sky. And so you need to keep in mind all these things and be ready, and when you study the Word, you need to remember, studying the Word doesn't mean go to your favorite author and read his commentary and believe what he says. Even King James Bible, which is from the correct manuscripts, there are so many people that has redone it. In other words, they added their commentary to it, and their commentary is based on their upbringing and how they interpret things. And so you can, it'd be not necessarily completely wise to accept totally other people's commentary on the Bible, even if the Bible that they're commentarying on is from the correct version. So we need to understand lots of things about the coming days. There are things that are going to be shocking. There are some sites you read that you just wonder how come they're even still online, because nothing's. So if you don't know Jesus right now, turn and say, Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God and that God rose you on the third day. A simple prayer gets you saved. And after accepting Jesus, there's something else for you. You can be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And that'll be, you can read about in Acts chapter 2. And you'll speak a different language. You can get several gifts of the Spirit. And part of this is healing. Healing hasn't gone away. It's for today. In fact, if you got a place of pain right now, touch that place. Touching it, in the name of Jesus, be healed. Again, I want to emphasize, read the King James Bible. That is where you get to know Jesus and find out what's really being said. A lot of interesting things going on, and reading the Bible is really neat to read how it happened in the beginning. And God has a great big universe here and lots of stuff in it that after he returns, he'll give you a place to go, and he's going to make a new earth and a new heaven. And we'll, before that, it will reign with him 1,000 years. If you accept Jesus now, you'll become a new creation. And then in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, you'll be changed. And you'll have a spirit body that will live forever and ever. And get to travel throughout all God's kingdom. And much more. We can't even fathom the things that will be in the new life that once Jesus returns and he becomes King of Kings, Lord of Lords, on earth as it is in heaven. And the best way to get ready is to accept him. Again, if you didn't pray that prayer earlier, pray it, a simple prayer. Just say, Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God and that God rose you on the third day, that you died on the cross, paying the price for my sins, that you were born of a virgin. Come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. Simple prayer gets you saved. And again, I'm going to repeat because it's pretty important. Getting baptized in the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2. You can get filled with the Holy Spirit and you'll be given more power to survive the days ahead as Jesus is about to return. And again, remember, the two witnesses are about to start their ministry. And if you find that you might not like them, that's one of the signs that they're going to be the two witnesses, because they're not going to be particularly loved by a good part of the church. And the church is going to want them killed, but they're going to have a very important message. And you'll see these two doing all kinds of things, like the plagues of Moses, like the 10 plagues of Moses. They're going to be able to do these things and more as often as they wish. So when you see two people out doing these kinds of things in the world, listen to what they say. It's pretty important that you get ready to hear their message. And some of you probably didn't put your hand on a place of pain a while ago, so I'm going to ask again, if you have a place of pain, or you could stand in proxy for another person you know that has pain, just put your hand on that part. You got your hand there? In the name of Jesus, be healed. And I come on a few times a week. You can go to seattlecommunitymedia.org and watch online and select Gaze for Jesus, and you can watch 24/7. So, I'll see you next week.
No matter what they tell you, no matter what they do, no matter what they teach you, what you believe is true.